Up in Your Business Podcast, Focus Forward Media.
I keep wanting to say Focus Forward Media.
You can say either.
My name is Brian Arnold, and welcome to the Up in Your Business Podcast. Rated PG for pretty good.
What an intro.
Love it. Let's start this thing off.
Ooh, that's hot. Coming in hot.
All right. He's here.
That's how you're going
to
start?
That's the intro right there. Let's go. Let's get into it now. Okay. Brian, great to have you here.
Good to be here.
It's episode 22, folks. Up in Your Business. We're here with the one and only Brian Arnold.
I'm the 2-2.
Also known as Brian Keith Media. And super excited for this one. Brian is a self-employed wedding photographer, commercial photography.
Yeah, do a little of everything.
Yeah, and you also do wedding videos.
Yes, yep. Videography. I'm trying to... I do photography, pretty much everything, but I'm trying to get video to breach the gap from weddings to other stuff, too.
Yeah, yeah,
because cool. I love videography, so cool. I'm going to try to get that going in other areas, too.
Cool.
I'm going to be, like, trying so hard this whole time not to sip this like this.
It's okay.
Hey, you're the guest. You can we do won't what judge you want. You.
So,
every time he sips, I want to turn this off.
All right, so I'm excited to have you here, Brian. Cool. Thanks for coming in. And we're going to kick it off with our segment, 20 Questions.
Mm.
You ready for this?
I was thinking about that on the way here.
Like, yeah, you heard it?
What are they going to ask me?
Oh, boy, here we go. Okay. So this segment is just like rapid-fire questions.
Mm-hmm.
So just answer as quick as possible. You ready?
Okay.
Favorite color?
Green.
Favorite snack?
Beef jerky.
iPhone or Android?
iPhone.
Left or right?
Left. You mean lefty or righty?
Just left lefty. Or right. Pick a number 1 to 10.
7.
Favorite number? Favorite number?
I don't have one.
Okay. Coffee or tea?
I feel like I had one when I was, you know, elementary school. But coffee.
Okay. Favorite drink?
I don't know. Like... If we're talking alcoholic beverage,
yeah,
probably
yeah.
Gin and tonics. All good right. Go-to G&T's. If it's not $13.
Yeah. Iced coffee or hot coffee?
Hot coffee.
Steak or chicken?
Steak.
Knew it. Oreo or Chips Ahoy?
Oreos.
Okay. Favorite vegetable?
Oh, these are tough. These are things that like you don't think about in a daily. What number are we at?
We're almost there. Favorite vegetable?
Avocado.
Mac or PC?
Pack or me see? Mac.
Work from home or in an office?
Office.
Your biggest inspirational role model?
My dad, because I work next to him every day.
Cool.
And he's still working his butt off at 57.
Cool. If you were at a four-way intersection, which way would you go?
What? Wherever my GPS told me to go.
Last time you ran a mile or close?
Oh, like last week.
Cool.
That's rare, though.
That's it.
Saying.
Ding, I'm not ding, a runner. Ding. I know you're not.
That was remember? Quick. I thought these were going to be like very in-depth.
Well, you had a tough time. So.
Nope, that's the podcast.
Am I supposed to be close like you guys are?
Doesn't matter. Whatever.
Yeah, you get a little bit closer around there.
Yeah. Cool. All right. You ready to get into this, Brian?
Let's do it.
That's it, actually. That's all we do.
Sweet.
Thanks for coming. All right. So this is one I always do. Just start it off. Tell us where you grew up and then sort of get into when and how did photography start for you. 1 second. He's drinking coffee.
oh, yeah. People are listening, not just... No, you have people just listening to the
right.
audio.
Yes.
That's right.
Yeah.
I got to keep that in mind.
Sorry, we got edit points.
So I grew up in Norton, Massachusetts. Still in good old Norton. It's a good, you know, location between a lot of different things, I mm-hmm. guess. Good between Providence, Cape Cod, Boston.
Yeah.
Still in Norton too. Yeah.
And so when and how did photography really start for you?
You know how it started. Skateboarding.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I got into like video editing. Me and my friends used to film ourselves skateboarding, and the editing part really, kind of drew my attention, just like piecing together all these pieces of a puzzle, and like you get to watch it over again and adding music to it. And it was like I was creating something that I'd see on TV, and I was like, this is so cool.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I think I started filming with my friend's camera briefly, and then I eventually got a VX2100.
Nice.
Which is like, as my first camera, that's just like...
At the time, that was like the god. Yeah. It was like the god of all skateboarding cameras.
Yeah. I didn't get the death lens, though. No. The big fisheye.
Yeah, yeah.
But I got, you know, a cheap eBay fisheye and yeah. filmed a lot of stuff. Started filming just stupid short film type funny videos with my friends.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I started with video. And then my senior year of high school, I got a first digital camera. So the 6.3 megapixel Canon... 300D, I think it was.
Oh my god,
something like that. Yeah, and
that was like the T1i, maybe, or like even before that. That.
It was a Rebel. It said Rebel on it.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was before the T series. It was 6.3 megapixel. And I heard online somewhere like someone said, you know, all you need is 6 megapixels to have a professional career, because those will print, you know, that'll yeah. print a decent size.
Yeah.
Viewing distance, in mind.
Yeah, yeah.
And I learned basically everything on that camera.
Wow.
And I took some decent photos.
You still have it?
I do. It's nice. Like...
That's your main wedding camera, right? That's what you use.
Yeah. Yeah. It's about $82 now on eBay.
But. That's funny.
So what made you lean towards video or photos initially instead of video if you started with video?
Man, I went to school at Bob Jones University in South Carolina. I was working on my bachelor's degree for cinema and video production for a couple of years with a minor in photography, just because like everyone that was in video major just tended to, you know, have a photo as a minor because they're pretty related. And after my first photo class, I still remember like the instructor was like just this much older guy who, you know, shot film 99% of his photography career, life, and he was very technical, really hard to please, very technical with composition and like exposure settings, aperture, shutter speed, all this stuff. And you know, we were shooting on 4x5 film, and then we went to 35mm film, and it was all just a very technical process. Developed our own film, all this stuff, and it just became this obsession. Like, I want to like. With this shot, like, how do I compose it perfectly? Like,
yeah,
like I was learning about like lead room, rule of thirds, and like leading lines, and just all the basic compositional elements. And then I was just like, yeah. So then it just became like I really got into stills. And then it was like I got into the beginner video aspect of it, and all the basic editing stuff, and then photography, advanced photography, and then it came back around to realizing that a lot of that stuff in photography is directly related to video anyways.
Yeah, yeah.
So when I switched to Hallmark Institute of Photography, I didn't finish my bachelor's degree. I wanted to switch to a photography school. So then I went to Hallmark, and they had a video course. So then I kept dabbling in video, and then by the end, I was like kind of just as much into video once again. So now I just do both. So cool. Yeah.
And how long was the program at Hallmark?
It was 10 months.
Oh,
it's pretty cool. They always say like it's basically 2 years crushed into 10 months. Like it was intense.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
I've heard of a few people. Obviously, we know Sean D that went there, and Sean Daugherty.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
When you said Sean, I was thinking of Sean Brown.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
That was like one of the first real like connections we realized we had at that wedding. We're like, you know this guy?
Yeah.
You grew up skateboarding with
him. And I skated with him, and we used to skate at Foxborough Skate Park sometimes. I filmed on my VX2000. So.
Oh, really?
I was pretty close.
What? My good friend had the VX1000.
Yeah.
That was a classic, too.
One of my friends has that now.
Oh, really?
I'm like, dude, it's like 30 years.
Does he still
use
it?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
He just got one like a year ago.
That guy Beagle from Death Wish, he still films with one of those, too.
Dude, I don't understand it.
It's probably like, you know, this that connection you have with... Like,
yeah.
You know, you're keeping the craft
right
back in the golden days. I don't know.
Yeah, I think people just still have that connection where they see that and like, ah, oh, classic. Like, it just is like, I don't know, almost like emotional maybe.
Yeah, but for sure.
Did you like the darkroom photography stuff that you did?
I loved shooting it. The darkroom was always so confusing. Well, not to mention the fact that you can't see, but... Yeah, it was cool. I like the smell of all the chemicals was very strong, and I've never smelled anything like it since.
I've never done a dark room.
Yeah, I did a class in school back college, and it was just cool to watch it go from literally every step taking the photo
mm-hmm.
and watching it just be created right in front of your eyes.
Yeah, it was awesome. Yeah. And then we did the printing room too, like the printing lab. We put the film up on the
enlarger.
Yeah, the enlarger, yeah. And then it would project light, and then you dodge and burn with the actual cardboard tools. Yeah.
Wait, you mean dodge and burn isn't just a Photoshop tool?
Oh, yeah. That is a physical tool.
You could put, like, filters on it, like sepia filters, like actual ones, not Instagram ones.
Not Instagram stuff. Filters?
Yeah. I never dealt with the filters. That's cool.
Yeah, you could, like, dye it so it looked a certain way. Oh, it was sick. Really cool.
Wow.
Yeah.
We should all do a darkroom little.
Whenever I try to remember what is brighter and darker, like dodging and burning, I can't remember which ones makes it brighter or darker. I always think about doing it in that lab. Like, okay,
really?
I take a dodge and I'm dodging.
Dodge is light, right?
I'm dodging. I even have to think about
it.
I think it's
burning. Because you're burning it in. So I think
burning is darker.
Darker, I'm darker. Pretty sure.
Yeah.
Because the light is making it darker.
Darker, yeah. Because the more light, the
dodging,
more exposure.
Dodging is dodging the light, less light. Which is brighter?
Photography 101, yeah, people.
This is talking photography.
Going back so many years. I still shoot 35 millimeter for fun.
Do you?
The thing about shooting film is, like, you can put, digitally, you can put any filter on it you want and make it look like film, but
yeah.
You only have so many filters that you can put on it, like, and it's disconnected from the actual image. And when you're shooting film, like those flares and those, like, lens flares and all those elements that happen that, like, leak into the, those are actual light caused by, you know, the light is coming from the actual place you were shooting.
Right.
And, like, and every photo is different. Like, it's, you're never going to get the same, you know, lens flare or tweak or weird grain patch or whatever. And sometimes it looks terrible, but it's like, oh, I went right over his face, but the next one's really good.
Yeah.
So
I'm curious, what happened after Hallmark when you first graduated from there? What was, like, job search and stuff like that?
Yeah. Well, it began at Hallmark, you know, as a student thinking about what I'm going to do when I get out.
Yeah, yeah.
At one point, I wanted to be a pet photographer. I was, like, completely sold on that because I just, like, dogs are just, like, my heart, you know.
You got a couple of dogs yourself.
I've always had two dogs. My family's always had two dogs growing up. And I did, like, almost every project assigned was something to do with dogs or pets. And so I started shooting pets. And then I realized maybe I'll just make this a side thing because I feel like it's going to be hard to make a decent amount of money doing just dog photography.
People do love their pets, though.
I was going to say, people will pay a little bit of money for that.
I do. I mean, I've seen a lot. And I feel like it probably is possible now, but it's a very specific.
Yeah.
You know,
very niche.
Yeah. So... And then just talking to other students, like Ryan Duvall, talking about weddings, he was saying, you know, he's always wanted to be a wedding photographer when we were at Hallmark, but he does like a ton of senior portraits. I'm like, man, I would love to do senior portraits. I don't know about weddings. Like, I've never even been to a wedding as a guest. I don't even know what happens. But I got a couple leads from friends before I graduated, scheduled the weddings. And then those two weddings right after Hallmark, my plan was to do weddings for a few years, you know, save some money, and then get into commercial eventually. But the weddings just, you know, kept coming.
Yeah.
And I started having fun with them.
Yeah.
And I shot like two weddings the first summer right out of school. And then the following year, you know, everyone sees their photos, their friends. And so then I had like four or five, and then I had like seven or eight the next year.
And what year was this? When did you graduate?
2012.
You graduated 2012.
That was my first summer. Had a couple weddings.
Okay.
And then it just snowball effect. So I kept I was getting like 12, 13 per year, and then I started advertising on the Knot, and then that pushed me up to, you know, the 20s, which was...
What are you at now?
Same, about 20s. 20s. Which I'm pretty good with.
Yeah.
You know, at first 20 was like, I like it, but I'm not making as much money, but now... You know, I'm charging a little more. You step it up every year, charging a little more. Now it's like, okay, I'm at the same number of weddings.
Right. And income is a lot better.
I'm, you know, better at you're used to the business. You learn a lot. And then,
Are you attending all 20 weddings? Or do you have a teams? Any teams you send out?
I've never I've never had people shoot on my behalf without without me there.
Is that because you like to have your names on it, so you want to have the control?
Well, that is a big part of it. I heard you and Matt Celeste talking about, you know, not naming your company after yourself.
Yeah, yeah.
Which sometimes I regret doing it, but there are some benefits to it. It's just a pros and cons. But yeah, that's part of it, is that it's Brian Keith Media. So like, I've never had anybody want to hire me that is expecting to have somebody else shoot.
I'd have to that point. I've had two or three weddings that, and you know, my wedding company is like Mike Neal and Media, but I've had two or three weddings that I sent other people to, 'cause I had weddings that day, and, knock on wood, like no complaints, no nothing. Everybody was happy.
That's good.
Product came out good. So I don't think it's, I think it's partly mental. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I guess I wouldn't push yourself too far. Like, if it comes to that point you want to, I don't think I would hold too far back from it.
Yeah, I think, I've talked to a couple of people who want to go through this transition and like from shooting just themselves to having a team. And we've talked about the different battles and, you know, challenges that come with it.
Yeah.
And one of them is when people hear about you and people are recommended to you, like they have a certain perspective of what they're going to get, and somehow making that clear to them before they even inquire, before they even send that first email, that, you know, they'd have a team, and sometimes it's not Mike Nealon going to shoot the wedding. Sometimes it's not Brian Keith Arnold going to shoot, which is really hard, because especially when it's named after yourself, and most of your referrals are
personal.
You need to hire this person instead of go with this company.
Right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, I've even thought about renaming my company. Like,
I mean, you could.
But, yeah. Anyway. Anyways, yes, I mostly myself. I've had, since I do photo and video, I've had people want to hire me for both, and I'm like, yo, I can't, you know, do both. One-man show, that's kind of a lot, unless I strap a GoPro to my forehead and use that for video.
I think, sorry to cut you off, that's an opportunity, I think, where you can start bringing in other people and figure out who you can trust, because at a wedding that you are doing photo and video, obviously you're only one person.
Yep.
So, like, we've gotten hired for photo and video, and we've worked with you, and we've worked with Matt Surratt, and talented people that we trust, and I think that's a good way to get into that.
Yeah, so that's exactly what I've done the past like three summers, maybe two, maybe 2018, 2019. Yeah. I started letting people book both. And so I'm like, you know, if you book both, what we do is we just have a lead shooter come in and do the photography, and we act as a team. Mm-hmm. And I edit everything, and I stay flexible to where, like, I'll shoot photos. If we go out for sunset photos and, like, you know, maybe the lead shooter that I hire isn't like super good with off camera flash. And you know, that's like what I love the most. I'll just be like, hey, let me do some sweet photos. Like, I have something in mind.
Yeah.
And if they're all going back to me anyways, I'm editing everything. So it's kind of cool.
Yeah.
You work together, you know, these DSLRs, I use the same one for photo and video. So it's like, it works out.
Yeah.
But
cool.
And it's been challenging. And I think the biggest challenge with that is you want to hire people you trust and are good enough, but those people who are at that level usually have their own business and don't want to start reserving dates for someone else.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's, you know, Move Mountains and Blue Flash, and, you know, I feel like most of the, you know, companies that are hiring lead shooters other than the owner of the company are dealing with those issues.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
It's like,
that makes sense.
Yeah, because the two or three people that I have hired to shoot lead for me do have their own company, and it's always like, okay, which one am I going to get? And that's the scariest part, because I want to hire someone I trust, and I don't want to just go with some random person to shoot lead photo for my client.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Especially when they're interacting with the client too.
Yeah.
That's the main person that is really carrying your name and how you react.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's tough, but you know, you just gotta go with the flow. Learn from the mistakes.
Right.
Cool. So when you first started out of college and started doing these weddings, did you have another job on the side that was paying your bills, or did you just get right into it with weddings and that was your only work?
Yeah, I had a few part-time jobs. Mm-hmm. I worked at Home Depot. I did some temp work with a temp agency, random jobs. And then I got a Home Depot job for like a year or so.
Pick things up and put them down.
Oh yeah. Dude, I didn't mind Home Depot. I've always been into like woodworking and
crafty.
Yeah. That type of thing.
And
it was like, it really fed my ADHD well. Walking through the aisles, just looking at stuff like, oh, I can do a project with that. Or like, you know, I could use that for a photo shoot, lighting section or the, you know, using things for backdrops. And it was kind of cool, other than like my shift started at 6 a.m. and I'm not a morning person. But then I worked at my dad's shop. He installs truck accessories and works on pickup trucks. Yeah. Basically just, you know, hitches, sidebars, tonneau covers. I don't know if you know what any of that is.
But
yeah. So all the accessories. So I was installing them for a long time with him just to help make sure I could pay the bills when I got an apartment. And then, eventually just got busy with photography and switched to full time. I was like, I don't think I need a part time job anymore.
Yeah.
And then, yeah.
So after leaving these jobs, or I guess after having these jobs, like when you went to quit them and just pursue being full-time weddings, like were you scared, were you nervous at all, like giving up a safe job, or were you pretty confident?
Well, those jobs were kind of, I always knew I could just get another part-time job. Worst comes to worst, which I didn't want to do, but
right. You knew that you could fall back on another part-time job.
Yeah. But it was a little sketchy. The first time the first week or two of just being full-time photo, but I kind of waited until the point where I had enough work. Like I didn't just take a leap of faith and say, okay, I got to book 15 weddings in the next 2 months or else I'm bankrupt. You know, I kind of waited till I was, busy enough. So I did it the safe way, I guess.
That's good though.
Yeah.
And so it's been almost 7 years now, 6-7 years.
Yeah. Wow. That's crazy.
So talk about some of the challenges you've had, like being self-employed along the way. Mm-hmm. Obviously it's not easy. And, being a creative, like there's much more to a business than just being creative. Obviously there's like keeping track of your finances, advertising,
You just said the biggest challenge right there.
Yeah. So
the bookkeeping.
Go through a little bit of it.
Well, I think it's a given, and anyone who in the creative field knows that, you know, us being, what is it, left brain people? No, right brain people are more creative.
No.
I think it is left.
Left. I thought it was left-handed people
are more creative. Well, you use your right brain for your left hand.
Yeah.
I don't know. Creative people just are, you know, have more challenges with the numbers and the business side of it in general. So that, and I think that's like, I think everyone who's in the industry knows that, and other than Matt Celeste, cause he's a genius. but like, yeah, like I think a lot of guys, that I know, including myself, just have a hard time with keeping up with, the bookkeeping and, just like going back and tracking all of your progress, tracking all of your, and being organized and looking at, just being organized and putting everything into charts. Like for example, like ROI or whatever, return on investment stuff. Like, okay, I put this much money into this and I've spent this many hours on this project and this many leads came from it. And what's my percentage of that? And I'm just worried about like, you know, keeping up with editing,
making sure the work gets done.
I'm just like, I want to do that, but I have all these personal projects I want to do too. And that looks,
have you ever thought
fun.
About hiring like a part-time bookkeeper?
I know. Cause the thing is, I know I could do the bookkeeping myself and I've gotten a lot better at it this year. And thanks to business coaching with Matt, but I've gotten a lot better at it. But I want to hire a part-time editor because I think
that's smart.
I think the editing takes up a big chunk of time.
Yeah.
And I feel like the bookkeeping is kind of more similar to emailing and client management and communication. I feel like if I could do all of that together, it'd be easier instead of like, you handle the bookkeeping and I'll do all the client stuff and the editing. You know, I think I would still do some editing, but I think that's the next step for me is
that's cool
to get someone to help editing in-house, not sending it off to photographersedit.com.
Is that an actual website?
They're good. They're good though. I was using them for a while. I think it's just, I'm just picky and I've used a couple other people and they did a great job. Like people that I know, they do great jobs with editing. It's just having someone, I think in person, you know, you can look over the shoulder and they can ask you their opinion about something. Yeah. And I think I really need to, you know,
I think it's cool too. I mean, that's a great way to grow. Like, you know, like you're saying, maybe at some point you'll change your name and you'll start growing and having someone you can rely on who then maybe grows with you. Like they start with just a couple hours a week or something and then they keep going. And
yeah. And even someone young, you can teach them your style and what you like and kind of breed them to make it so it works out.
And I'm new to that, to breaching into that area, because it's like when I think about getting someone that's young and just starting out, it's like how much are you going to have to teach them and are you going to pay for all those training hours? And
it's I mean, just like you just said, return on investment, like you got to put some time into it. I mean, you're paying them and, you know, you're going to spend some time like teaching them.
Right.
And you got to think too, like they could learn all this stuff and be like, all right, see you later. You know, like they could ditch out.
Yeah, I think it's like you have to find a balance of where, like, okay, I want this person to know how to use Lightroom, but I don't expect them to know my style, you know? It'd be nice to get someone like right out of high school who's just interested in it.
Yeah.
But if they don't know how to boot up Lightroom and go to the develop tab, that's a lot of, you know, training. And so that's kind of what I've been thinking about. And I think in the off season of weddings, like this winter, I'll probably sit down and do a lot of just brainstorming and writing strategy. Out ideas and see how I'm going to approach it.
Cool.
So
actually to your point, you started to bring up there, you know, being self-employed isn't always easy and there's a lot of different aspects to it.
Mm-hmm.
What are your thoughts and experiences with like coaching or having like a business mentor or something like that?
Yeah. So as I briefly mentioned, Matt Celeste, who you had on here.
Shout out, Matt, if you're listening.
Yeah, yeah. Shout out, Matt. You're the man. I saw him post at some point a long time ago about something to do with business coaching or some sort of something to do with business, like meeting one-on-one. And I had always remembered that. And so, like, last spring, I hit him up and asked if he wanted to take on anyone. And he's like, yeah, I haven't really even done anything with that. I'm like, cool. Okay, let me be your first guy because I need
I'll
help.
I'll be your test dummy.
I need help. So I think the hardest thing and what I needed help with most is I had all these tools, right? I had 17 hats that would manage my business, like help organize my invoices and contracts and contacts and, like, you know, all that stuff.
Yeah.
And it's super helpful. But they also have bookkeeping section and they have like a invoice income tracking and then I had QuickBooks Self-Employed and then I had you know, these other things that tracked all my expenses and and just like my calendar app and I also had a calendar on my 17 hats and like all these things, all these tools that I could use and they're all just a mess. Like they're all getting all this information and I'm not keeping track of them because I don't know which one's the best to use. At the end of the year I'm just kind of like going back throughout the whole year and just saying, okay, let me figure out how much I made instead of keeping up with it week by week, month by month. So, you know, and it got the job done eventually, but it was a mess. And so he's been helping me with that. And it's been really helpful to be like, hey, what's your take on this? Cause like, I think it helps to have a third opinion in any situation or a second opinion or whatever, someone who can just look at everything and just have a non-biased view. Whereas, you know, I've been going through this throughout all the years and just adding to my tool belt piece by piece and not really, I guess, like, being able to step back and see with like as clear of a view because it's just so much clutter building up.
Yeah.
And,
something a little more organized.
Yeah, I guess.
So what's been like the most helpful, if you have like one example specifically?
Well, the whole, yeah, having someone like that in general. Just, I think I've always said, like, it's been really helpful just to be part of a community, like you guys, Sean, Matt, yeah, like Lauren Halverson, and, you know, all these people that I've been shooting for and talking to, and all these connections that you make. And each person has different strengths and weaknesses, like,
yeah,
you know, and you get to know the person, and you kind of like, you learn from them and their style and their strengths and weaknesses, and ask them questions. And, you know, we refer each other work all the time, which is another benefit, but
yeah,
just like learning how other people do business, and which is great that you're doing this podcast. It's along the same, like, you know, you can benefit in the same way from that. So that's been really helpful, is to just be social and be nice and like be selfless and like want to help people. And then like they help you, and just be friends with them and talk business, you know, cause everyone does it a different way. And there's so many different ways to do it that you can learn and benefit from. Like, you know, you may not copy someone completely, but like you take little things like, oh, I can implement that small piece of what they're doing.
Yeah, into exactly.
To my workflow.
That's, I was going to say, like, there's like little things you can pick up that you're like, oh, I didn't think about it that way. Like, maybe I can attack this problem this way, or maybe I can develop that in that way.
That's a big thing I noticed about the community around here too, is that it's not really competitive. It's like kind of collaborative.
Yeah.
I think that's a good way to look at it.
I think the ones that get too competitive end up getting isolated. Like, you know, like it's like you don't hear from them much because, you know, if you're too competitive, you don't want to be too friendly. And
yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah, it's like, how is he going to take advantage of me? Like, you know?
Yeah. And it's funny. I was on, shout out Joe Kelly, if you're listening, Mass Construction Show. I was on this other podcast with a friend of ours who has a podcast. He does a construction podcast. And he asked me, he's like, hey, you know, you bring in on your podcast, like, a lot of times, like, your competition. Like, what's your thought process there? And, like, what's your take? And I'm like, I said, it doesn't even, like, cross my mind that way, because there's enough business for everybody. Like, yeah, sure, like, you do wedding video and photography, so do I, like, we do weddings. Like, it doesn't even cross my mind. Like, you have your certain client, and there's people who love your style, there's people who love my style, our style. Like,
yeah,
there's enough couples, and there's enough, like, business. There's just so much work, and there's just a lot more to be done that way.
Yeah, for sure.
And the crossover too, where you go into the corporate gig, where if we get we need a photographer, all of a sudden we're gonna reach out to you.
And I think I always wonder, like, what clients would think of that. Like, you know, we're hiring each other for weddings, but we're all like, also have our own companies. Do they know that, like, when I, you know, when I shoot for Mike Nealon, that they're getting Brian Keith? Like, are they like, oh, all these people in this, like, community, they're just like basically giving each other jobs. Like,
yeah.
Like,
it's so funny to think about. It's so funny to think about.
Like, if you were hiring a wedding photographer and they're just like, I'm booked on that day, but I can subcontract to, like, some other guy who has his own company.
Yeah.
And I'm like, wait, who am I hiring? I always wondered if clients thought that. But I mean, at the end of the day, like, I'd be doing all the editing, or you'd be doing all the editing if they're hiring you anyway. So it's like, a lot of it is the editing too. But
that's what sets it apart, I think.
Yeah.
Because that's where you put your style into it.
Well, there's a certain threshold, because, like, you know, you can only do so much. You know, you got to get it right in camera.
Yeah, that's very true.
Some people have such a wacky style that it's like, well, editing can't save this, can't change the style of this. But, like,
the time I shot for you.
And yeah. Wait, did you shoot for me? No.
I don't think we've ever shot together, except, like, when I've... You've never hired me, basically.
Kaylina and Andrew, we were. Met.
That was actually... So, you know what's funny is... So, 2 years... It was a little bit over 2 years ago we first met. It was at Union Bluff in Maine.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow, what kind of douchebag is driving this car? Like,
I probably just got it. Turned out it's this nice guy.
I think you did, because you were... Because then we were talking, I was like, oh, that car's sweet. And you were like, yeah, I just got it. And but it was so funny, because when we first met at that wedding, you seemed so familiar. I was like, why do I know this kid? And I don't know if we had ever, like, run into each other at like Norfolk Skate Park or like Foxborough Skate Park or something, but you had just like this familiar face and we just kind of like hit it off right away.
Yeah, it was all downhill from there, Mike.
I saw on your Instagram that you went to a wedding this past weekend.
Yes.
How do you view weddings differently attending them?
Yeah.
And then when you're going to shoot them, do you like judge the camera people? Because I know I do.
Well, yesterday I was doing a lot of the photography myself.
Oh, you were?
I was a groomsman. And it's definitely different when you go as a guest.
Yeah.
It's very, I've only been to a guest a couple of times. I think if I was a guest at a wedding more often, I'd be able to relax more. Yeah. But yeah, when I'm a guest, I'm just like watching.
You didn't
watching.
Bring your camera, did you?
Yes, last weekend. Yeah, I did. Because, so I was on stage during the ceremony because I was a groomsman.
Yeah.
And they had some kid shooting the ceremony, just like some guy that goes to the church they had the ceremony at. That they knew, you know, he did it for like, you know, $50 or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they couldn't really, they didn't really want to hire, you know, the big ordeal. It was kind
of
a small
wedding.
They
didn't want to hire Brian Keith Media.
Yeah, well, they basically did because he shot the ceremony and then after I shot all the portraits that did not involve groomsmen.
Yeah.
And then that other kid shot to like bridal party. So, and then I did like bride and groom portraits.
Oh, cool.
And it's different because it's like, I don't want to be working, but at the same time, like, this is my best friend.
Yeah. Like, you want to help out.
And it's kind of special that, because they're going to have these pictures on their walls forever. Like,
yeah.
Right.
And the rest of their life. And like, it's cool that knowing that I took them instead of just staying there watching them being taken. Yeah. Like, I don't want to work. I want to relax, but it's worth it to, you know, I'm kind of working, but I'm shooting my best friend's wedding photos. It's the same thing with my cousin. He got married recently and I did his video.
Yeah.
And I did full on, you know, the whole time I was shooting, like, I gave him the whole thing.
Yeah.
And
you're a nice guy.
Yeah, I would. Well, they paid me a little bit.
Oh, okay.
The family discount. Cool. Yeah. But I was shooting, and I really did want to just drink and have fun because it's my cousin's wedding and the family's there. Yeah. But it was also cool, like, I can sacrifice a little bit of fun on your wedding day for you having a video that your cousin made. The whole, like, for the rest of your life. So.
Yeah, it becomes personal at that point.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I had both you guys at my best friend's wedding. They wanted me to do it, but they were like, well, we also want you to be there. And I was like, perfect solution.
So we'll subcontract it out to other companies.
I had four companies there.
Wait, so it was me.
I had Brian Keith Media, Matt Shred Productions, Focus Forward Media.
Yeah, that's great.
Mike Mealon Media, sort of. Yeah. I edited the video and I edited the photos, but.
I
have to show you the video, actually. I don't know if I sent it to you.
Did you put any of your speech in there?
I did, a little bit.
The whole thing.
No, I didn't.
Narrated the whole video.
Shut up. That's a liar. I'll have to show you.
It's like starts and ends with your speech the whole time.
Those and there's actually no B-roll. It's just my speech. And then like one shot of them.
Looking at you while you talk.
No, but the sunset stuff.
Yeah, the sunset photos you took look amazing.
Those are some of the best ones.
And you know what's so funny is going through the video, all I hear was, oh my God, these are amazing. I love it.
Wait, whose voice is that?
You.
What do you mean? I wasn't doing the video. Oh.
Because I was background shooting photos.
Yeah. I was
You're like, oh, I love these. You guys look so good. All right, Matt, do that again. Oh, these look so.
It was so funny.
Well,
that's awesome. You got to get passionate with your work, right?
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. You got to give some feedback to the client so they feel comfortable.
Yeah.
Like I'm doing it right? Okay.
Yeah.
I try.
No, they came out good, though. That was fun. It was cool to see you guys all work together. I got to tell you, you know, like, top-notch job. Everybody complimented you guys.
Mm.
You all worked together like a nice little team.
Nice little team.
Like one little family.
Would you look at that?
I know. Yeah. But, so that's interesting.
Ask me another question. Damn it.
I got another one. What would you say is the, like, maybe your favorite thing about shooting weddings and then maybe something that's your least
open bars.
Least favorite.
Open bar is my favorite.
Do you drink while you do photography? Do you do any of the shoots?
I take it one wedding at a time. So sometimes, like, if it's a friend's wedding or, like, the client's just, like, has became a good friend.
Yeah.
And, like, they're telling me to get
offers
a drink.
Like six times. Yeah.
Or like get a drink with your dinner or whatever. Yeah. Then I'll drink, but not never over like a one or two.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like you don't want to get tipsy.
Like you're getting hammered and trying to take photos.
So it's
this
definitely.
This photo looks sick.
But most of the time, we pull an Elon Musk and do it at the wet. No. most of the time, yeah, I don't. But what was your question? Favorite thing about weddings?
Yeah, like maybe like one favorite thing and then one least favorite.
Favorite is getting to set up really good photos with great light. Just like I love off-camera flash stuff.
Yeah, you
working
do.
With great like locations because like you know it's a wedding and they're having this event at the best location they can afford and like it's and I've been to really awesome venues. So we get to go. I mean, not only do we get to go to these beautiful places, but everyone just looks their best they've ever looked in their life.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, bride and groom, bridal party. You know, some of the guests keep it casual, but you know, we get to work with these people who are dressed up, and we don't have to worry about it. We don't have to hire a stylist. We don't have to hire a makeup artist.
Yeah, yeah.
And we just get these beautiful people to take pictures of in these beautiful places.
Yeah.
So I like that part of it, but the part that sucks is that all of that, but yet we're just so time constrained. Like we have such a time constraint. Like you know, if they don't do a first look. We get squeeze everything in cocktail hour, and I get 10 minutes to take pictures of the bride and groom, and that's like torture. It's like, dude, like, you know, I want to be able to have free creative freedom, and that's one thing I like about commercial work. That's one of the reasons why I want to go to commercial work, and like portraits, even senior portraits are fun.
Yeah.
Because you get freedom. Like, if you give extra time to the client, if you take more time to make it perfect, like they. Appreciate it. Like you're giving them extra.
You go the extra mile and they notice.
Whereas weddings, you take too long. It's like you're cutting into reception time. Like whatever. You're getting.
Yeah, it's a stressful day.
Yelled at by the coordinator. So that's probably what I like the least. Yeah.
Little do they know though is that those little couple extra minutes is going to make such a big difference. Just you know, set up that light a little bit differently or to make one little change.
Yeah, I feel like. Usually the best photos come towards the end of the session because you're just perfecting it the whole time.
Yeah,
and then towards the end you're like, yes,
I agree.
And unless the sun's just like right on the horizon, you only have 3 minutes until it's disappeared.
Yeah. Doing weddings, obviously, they're 90% of the time they're on Saturday or Sunday. Like, how does that work with you? Like, do you ever get tired of working weekends, or right now you're still at the point where it's okay? Or
yeah, I think the tough part is like. Well, during the week, I try to work the same as my work normal hours. So, like, when I'm done with work, my friends who work normal schedules are done with work, and then I can actually hang out with them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like, and then it's the balance between that and like the temptation to sleep in and like, you know, go to the gym, start work at 2 p.m., work all the night till 2 a.m. And it's like, I'm not going to have a social life if I do that.
Right.
And so then. And weekends, it's like everybody's, you know, obviously doing stuff and having fun and all the events happen. And Facebook reminds you of all of the events in your area that you're missing.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's definitely a struggle. And especially like, you know, I like to prioritize, you know, being involved at my church. I do a lot of like the camera work there and stuff. And that's really just eating into that really bad.
Do you try to take, sorry, when you have maybe a wedding, a weekend with double weddings like Saturday and Sunday, do you try to take like 1 or 2 days off during the week so that you at least have some time off, or do you just go straight through?
Usually it's just, I'll take the Monday off.
Oh, okay.
And my dad, so my like studio is like, we renovated a small building next to my dad's shop. So my dad's off Mondays. So if that happens, I'll like, you know, I'll take off Monday because maybe I'll like do something with my parents or whatever. But yeah, usually if it's like a triple wedding weekend, I'll take Monday to recover.
Yeah.
Actually, this wedding is a triple. And I'm
this coming weekend.
Speaking of subcontracting, I'm shooting for Blue Flash, Move Mountains, and Lauren Halverson.
This weekend?
All three.
Friday, Saturday, Sunday?
Yeah.
No shit.
But no editing. All this three, no editing.
There you go. Have fun, Sean, Matt, and Lauren.
Yeah. Actually, I might have to edit one for Blue Flash. Oh. But whatever. Well.
And what are your thoughts on like, because I just had this conversation actually with someone from Wedding Wire yesterday. But, you know, like, I guess moving forward, like, how much do you like to second shoot versus like doing your own weddings?
I like second shooting. Mm-hmm. I think, I mean, obviously, the hard part about it is, like, I think if you take too many second shooting weddings, you can't do, like,
your own.
You know, if you reserve dates on second shooting weddings, you can't do your own. And if you're a full-time photographer, running your own business, and if weddings are, like, most of your income, most of your, you know, bread and butter, then you know, you gotta make money somehow. And there's only so many Saturdays and Sundays or Saturdays in a year. But it is nice. Yeah. Second shooting is nice because you know, less to worry about, you know, doing the job. If I, you know, second shoot for a wedding and I put 100% effort in and just do everything I'm supposed to do as the best that I can, it's still not as stressful as lead shooting.
Yeah.
Even if you're taking it easy. So
that's why I have you lead shoot for me usually. So it's more stressful for you.
Well, it's okay. Kidding. I'll take the stress, make a little money.
No, but you know what I did like? You know what else I heard in the camera audio was you saying, I'm going to try to make as little work for Mike as possible. So you shot your photos really nicely. So I didn't have to do a ton.
Did I say that?
I think you did. I remember.
I think I said the opposite.
And I literally heard him go, nah, we'll just give him as much work as possible.
I think I might remember that.
It was when we were shooting Brie.
Oh, gotcha.
In her hotel room.
Yeah. That's funny.
But I appreciate it.
Dude, I got you. I know how it is, the editing. And that's the other thing about second shooting is you don't have to do that.
Yeah.
But I mean, that's nice of you, you know, because a lot of people just be like, oh, take whatever I got, you know, they don't really
fix it in post.
Yeah.
I get really self-conscious about shooting when I know other people are editing.
Yeah, me too.
And it's funny because over the years I've been critiquing my second shooters, and now that I'm shooting for a lot more for like Move Mountains, you know, they're doing the critique now, and I'm like learning what it's like to get critiqued. And it's like, it took me a couple times getting feedback, but now I'm like, you know what, I need to be teachable. Like, I've always tried to remember to be teachable. Like, that's one,
yeah, it's a challenge.
That's one trait that I think, you know, if you have that, then as long as you're willing to learn and be and accept the fact that you have a lot to learn and be teachable,
and you're not
be flexible.
Perfect. Yeah.
Like, that is one of the best traits that you can have in business. Always be changing, always be growing, and be humble about it. Like, and that's a challenge, especially when you're getting feedback from a wedding that you shot and you're like, you did all this stuff wrong.
Yeah.
You're like, no, I did that. You don't understand. I did this because of this. And it's like, well, okay. Wasn't the best thing to do.
Right.
Just like, it's fine.
But I mean, it's important how you take those lessons, and instead of getting discouraged, you turn around and don't make those mistakes again, or change up your ways a little bit and learn from it. That's the learning lesson is the biggest part.
Yeah,
for sure. And that's another benefit from, like being a part of the community of that we're in this industry.
It's cool.
Yeah, for sure.
Because nobody's a master at anything.
Right.
You can always learn more. You know, like I'm on YouTube all the time watching videos and like, you know, checking out cameras and doing different things. And you can, everything's always growing.
Yeah. I mean, just recently last weekend, we shot a commercial for one of our clients on Saturday, and we just like tried to implement this new thing, and we just like looked up how to do it, and we're like, all right, yeah, let's try and figure it out and learn how to do this so we can like make this video look a little bit better.
Yeah.
It's cool.
And I always, once in a while, I'll see, usually it's like a videographer, sometimes a photographer at a wedding who just like, you look at them and the first thing you think is like they're stuck in 1998, like with their really tiny little camcorder that has this big cage around it with this big microphone. And they have this big shoulder rig.
Yeah.
And it's like, I mean, not that shoulder rigs are bad or microphones are bad, but it's like, you just like, you need to, and I remember one in particular, this team of two guys, and they were just so old school. It wasn't even funny.
Yeah.
And then when I looked at the videos, it was even worse. Ugh. Like, I was like, wow, this is even worse than I expected. But we sat down with them at dinner. I mean, really nice guys, don't get me wrong.
A
lot of those guys are super nice and talkative, and
they're just stuck in their ways.
And what he said to me was, he was like, you know, people don't do weddings like they used to. I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, they used to do the whole thing, the whole, you know, big fancy wedding and hire videographers. People just don't want videos anymore. I'm like, what do you mean they don't hire you? He's like, yeah, I don't get as many. Like, I used to book 30 a year, and now I got like 4 this year. And I'm like, he's like, people, you know, the video's dying or whatever. And I'm like, it's not dying for me.
It's getting so much
I'm like, man, you just, you know, be teachable, be, you know, and here's this older guy who, you know, we need to respect. He paved the way for us.
Sure.
Like, if it wasn't for him doing what he did, people wouldn't feel the need to have a videographer.
Yeah.
People like that really popularized and kept it moving for weddings, but which is, I respect that, but at the same time, it's like, man, don't complain about not getting work if you're not willing to change.
Yeah.
You gotta grow with the times.
Yeah. And so it's something that takes being humble, I think.
Yeah.
And yeah. I don't know how we got
it. I got my second to last question.
Okay. Do you want to talk about like commercial work at all?
Yeah, I was going to ask you a question on that.
That's good.
Go for it.
I was going to say, because you were talking about all your corporate stuff and how you're trying to switch over. Like, mm-hmm. How do you plan on doing that? And do you have anything in the pipeline?
So I was like, you know, I'll increase my wedding prices and probably not book as many. But I'm starting to, you know, I'm still booking, which is good. I increased my price significantly for weddings. And I was expecting to have more time. And that's part of the reason why I wanted to get an editor, is because I want to free up some time for just trying to get new commercial leads in. I've done a few, like I do headshots for Mansfield Bank in my area. Like I've done like work with, you know, real estate agencies, like headshots and stuff. And
yeah.
There's this small company in Attleboro that's been repeat business for me for like a few years. They make fragrance spray bottles like for interior of houses. So we do like styled shoots and drop and pops for their website, you know, white background stuff. Just miscellaneous stuff that just come. I just take it as it comes. I haven't been like trying much. Anyways, that's what I've been doing. That's what I have, the work that I have now.
Do you do that all under the same production company too?
Yeah, same title. And I've thought about, like, when I want to start either advertising for commercial work or just, like, getting referrals, like, you know, doing... I was talking to my buddy at the Ari event, Ari. Is it Ari? Yeah. I've always said Ari. A couple people there said Ari. I was like, it's not airy.
I don't know what they're talking about.
It doesn't look airy. And I was talking to my buddy Brian Zatora, who...
Oh, I know Brian.
I was going to say, do you know Brian Zatora?
Brian's a man.
He was another skateboard world connection from back in the day. He used to skate at Mansfield
Skateboard. He's a cool guy. Board. I like him a lot.
Yeah. So he's doing really well. Doing a lot of... He said he did weddings for a couple of years and he got drained. And then now he's doing a lot of like lot corporate of films. And stuff.
Films and corporate, yeah. Like I was on a shoot with them once.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So he was there and we were just catching up. So he said pretty much most of like the... I hope he doesn't mind me sharing this. I don't know if he'll be even listening to this. But he said a lot of his like big clients connect back somehow to a free job that he did. You know, he did a job for free for someone for the portfolio, or he did a job to get referrals. You know, he's like, we'll do this for you, but we just need like, you know, connections and referrals. So I want to start doing that. And it's humbling to think that I'm going to do free stuff.
He's a big proponent of free work. And I've talked to him about it before. Okay. He has an interesting take on it. I mean, just like you said, like he does it so that he can get referrals and stuff.
Yeah.
I remember I shot a TEDx event with him. And
nice.
And it was one that he did for free, which is that's maybe an event that I'd consider doing for free because you're
right.
Like, yeah, I did the TEDx in Cambridge. Like, it's like one of the biggest. TEDx is fucking huge. So he probably met so many people and they shoot the after party and stuff like that. Yeah. So,
nice.
I
feel like it's
give him credit.
Yeah. It's kind of humbling. Cause it's like, you know, I've been in this for 7 years. Like I'm not going to do anything for free.
Right.
But at the same time, I'm kind of new to the commercial side of it, corporate side of it, even though I have done a decent amount,
yeah.
But mostly like local companies, smaller projects. I feel fully capable, but it's like at the same time, like the client doesn't know that. Like,
right.
You know, if you don't have work to show for it, I guess you got to make compromises.
Yeah.
And yeah. So, back to the original question, my plan for doing that. Yeah, just like reaching out to companies. And I heard ad agency work is not that fun, because like you're kind of, I heard it's like a lot better to go directly to the client, because like basically the ad agency is your client and you're doing what they want. They have the vision. You don't really get that much creative freedom.
Well, there's also like, I mean, yeah, it definitely depends with the agency. I think someone like us, like when we hire out photographers, like I would say we try our best not to, obviously there's a certain vision that the client probably has in mind, but I think we try our best as creatives to let the photographers do their creative thing and do their best work. And
I'd say we give them like guidelines. Yeah, we're not really like, you like a shot, we'll give them a shot list, but be like, hey, if you see anything else, you know, feel free to capture it while you're there.
Yeah. So there's a lot to learn on that end.
A big thing with us too, it might come up with you with hiring contractors, is that I feel like me and Mike always try to be fair to, you know, everybody that we hire. We try to ask them their rates, try to get them their rates, if not more.
Yeah.
If we can squeeze it into the project, because, you know, they're going to work harder for you if you're going to spend the extra money on them.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. That's true. If they feel like they're getting cut short, they're going to do a half-assed job.
Yeah, they're not going to care about
because
it.
Because we've had the experience of coming from an agency that really throttled us, pricing, creativity, and all that, and didn't turn out good. That's why we're here.
Yeah. So, hey, you learn from everything.
Yeah.
Everything's an experience.
Well, this is a fantastic studio setup.
Thanks, man.
I love it.
Yeah, you're welcome to use it whenever you want.
Sweet.
Yeah. It's only $500 an hour.
Nice. Just kidding. Dude, I can afford it, man. Not really.
Second to last question.
Okay.
Or kind of two questions in one. What's one aspect of photography in general that you've really focused on and developed over the years that's become maybe like your strength? And then what are like future plans for the business and anything like that?
One aspect that I've developed and has become,
I bet I know exactly,
a strong point. Technically wise, like as far as like in camera and actually shooting, or like business related,
either way.
I mean, I think video, the past, like I've always known a lot of the same things and techniques for photography, and not to undermine photography at all, but there's not as much that goes into it.
Yeah.
Like flash, off camera flash, like learning how that works with shutter speed and, you know, balancing ambient and strobe and, and like there's not that much else that's like super complicated, just like composition and getting the shots you need on the shot list. Yeah. However, sorry, video is, there's a lot more to it. And I've definitely, like over the past 2 years, my video has changed so much. And whether it's stabilization or audio, getting better audio, which still is lagging behind a lot because, you know, I'm a visual guy and audio just doesn't make sense to my mind a lot of the time. And also editing too, like that's probably more than half of what I'm referring to is just like the editing, using LUTs, using looks, like making it look cinematic. And, you know, I got a subscription to Artlist, and that was huge because now I can pick royalty free music that's super, you know, they're not paying me for this. That'd be cool if they were. That's super cinematic, and just like all these different, you know, songs, I don't have to worry about copyright anymore. This past year I started getting into After Effects, doing like 3D text and stuff.
Yeah, I've seen some of that. It looks good.
Yeah, it's complicated. I need to get better. I think with that you need to shoot it with the 3D text in mind.
Yeah.
Because there's like
certain ways to shoot it that'll make it easier in post.
Yeah, and make it look a lot better. But yeah, video has definitely cool. Like you look at my videos for like 4 years ago, it's just like, man, it just looks so like, I don't know. I think switching to Sony was a big thing too. I mean, I could have upgraded my Canon, but switching to Sony was, Sony's just been like
great,
fantastic for video.
Paid ad for Sony.
Yeah.
There's your ad. Cool. Yeah, and then what are the future plans for the business?
Future plans.
Anything big on mind?
Shoot more commercial work.
Cool.
Shoot more of what I love. I really loved making those travel videos, like India. Like when I edit those, like
those are cool.
I don't even want to stop editing. I'm like, it's just so fun to just like edit video footage from a different part of the world and just make a travel video. It's like, you know, obviously it doesn't pay the bills, but unless you're Peter McKinnon, but yeah, that's do more of what I love. And like, I think do more commercial work, and I don't know. I think I eventually want to move out of the studio I'm in now and get a bigger space. And I love being around my dad every day, and my mom always ends up driving by and how you doing? You need anything today? And I'm like, Ma, I'm an adult. Like, cause
but yeah, I'll take a sandwich.
She's retired. And like, I live right next to my studio, which is right next to my dad's business. And so I see him every day, and like, she doesn't have much to do. So she's always driving over and like visiting him and then popping into my studio. And I'm like, I love my parents, but I kinda, I just feel too connected. You know? Like, I'm getting old. I want to like get out and like.
There's a space around the hall. Like right
is it?
Yeah, that's open. It's a good
spot. Oh, really?
Yeah, I'll show you on the way out.
Okay, sweet.
Cool. You getting commission on that or something?
I don't know.
Dude, there's a lot of you know, things we could get paid for that we're shooting, that we're referencing.
I know,
in this
right?
podcast.
Start putting out to my hands.
Yeah.
Cool, man. Well, appreciate you coming in, Brian.
I feel like
it was fun.
Yeah, I feel like there's a lot. I feel like I could have stepped up my game better with my.
Nah, you're great, dude.
Mike Nealon was one man on a mission to make a podcast.
Tell everybody where they can find your stuff, your website, Instagram, all that.
Like, follow, subscribe, share. so I've been posting those travel videos, and like, everyone's telling me I should, like, you know, start a YouTube page and get all, you know, be like a YouTuber.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I just can't be the guy that's just like talking to the camera, like all fake and like, make sure you like, follow, and subscribe, like right down there. I was like, I can't do that. Yeah, I don't know. Right. I've seen too much of that.
Yeah.
I don't know. And there's nothing wrong with it.
Yeah.
I'm just like, I just want people to enjoy it. I'm not doing it for.
Where are they? Where are the videos?
They're on YouTube.
They are on YouTube.
The India ones. There's 5 India videos, and I'm trying to finish the last one. I went to India in freaking February, and I still have to finish editing that. I just filmed too much. There's just too much
to
see.
You got a lot of work to do.
Yeah.
It's eye candy when you're over. India is so colorful. Like, there's so there's colors, there's different food. It's like a different culture, and you're just shooting everything.
Did you go for work, or was it
just
vacation?
For fun.
Yeah. You just brought the camera?
My roommate from that first college I went to is from there.
Cool.
So I went to see him again. Visit. He's actually getting married in April, so I'm going back again.
Nice.
Apparently.
You're shooting it?
I'll probably make a video, yeah. I'll probably. Cool. And then take a year to edit it.
Yeah, exactly.
What was your question? Oh.
Social media.
Give yourself a plug. What's your Instagram
Brian
handle?
Brian Keith Media. @ BRIANKEITHMEDIA.
And your website is BrianKeithMedia.com.
Yeah. BrianKeithMedia.com. Brian Keith Media, Facebook.
Same, we'll tag it.
Same crap.
Cool.
All and right. If you can find my personal page, you can follow that too, but you'll never find it. It's hidden. It's personal.
Cool.
Only the elect will know.
Okay, we're done here.
Are we done?
Guys, thanks for listening. If you enjoyed this, let us know in the comments of the Instagram post or leave a rating. Subscribe to the podcast. Pass it along to your friends. Brian, shut up. And
I kind of like it.
Hope you guys enjoy
Focus
the next one.
Media.
And check us out on Instagram @ Up in Your Biz Pod.
Up in Your Biz.
And we're gonna leave now because Brian's done. Goodbye.
Chew. Did that work though?
That'd be perfect. That kind of sounded good.